Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we are back with the top four of the Curtain Games Southwest UK Regional.
The creme de la creme.
Yeah, we are. We're getting to the end. It's now 11
p.m. GMT. We've been here since 8:30 this morning.
You're joined by myself, Liam, and we've also got the wonderful, soulful voice of Cookie.
Indeed, I am here for you all.
So we are now starting. So we've got Michael Bonney, who was on stream last game.
I found an interesting fact about Michael during the break there. Apparently this is his first ever tournament he's been to. Yeah.
He's played in one local play around, one in his local scene, but his first major event that he's tried doing, and he's made top four. That's
I'm impressed. I've been playing since it came to his first printing, first edition, and I've never achieved a lofty height to attain this rapidly.
I know. So Michael on his first event, he's now up against Andy Cameron, seasoned tryhard.
Yep, taking a game against Stephen Gage in the last one. Beautiful game finish to watch there. Stephen Gage desperately trying to claw out a points advantage without losing half health on his dash. Just not managed to do it, but smiles all around and handshakes at the end there.
So Andy managed to take the top eight game the same way he took the top 16 game with that wonderful last second dice roll.
Yep.
To get the half points to give him a...
I think he was 1 point up anyway. He was on a half... Half a Sarge Ventress?
So Sarge was off the board, and it was a half point Manaroo? It might be the other way around.
Manaroo off the board, Manaroo being the cheapest of the three ships in that list. Sarge was just on half. Fenn still having some hit points and being a small ship and still the full points. Stephen was down by, I think, a point or two, maybe. They didn't know to the end, they didn't have time to work it out because they were both going for the kills. That's what we'd like to see. A bit of aggressive play.
Yeah.
Not just trying to point it out at the end.
Not on stream, on the other table, we have school friends, local friends, playmates, and I actually need to disappear and go and get that game recorded.
Liam rapidly moving away to set up the second camera here. Simon Richardson. Smile now gone, game face set, ready to go. So we're seeing here the initial moves coming out of Andy Cameron and Michael, I believe it's Bonner. It's been misspelled on the screen, so apologies to Michael there. They're still in the placement phase. So Andy Cameron here, he's been playing this list. Andy Cameron, excellent player, hardcore tournament player. Will pick a list, he will run that list for a number of tournaments, number of months, getting proficient with it. And that is, if you're looking to place highly, looking to get that sweet swag, that's the way to go about it. Michael Bonner, on the other hand, this is his first major event. Punching well, though. We put him down a little bit last time, but he showed us wrong. That snap Wexy coming in with the outmaneuver. Lots of pieces to his list that we don't usually see. It's great to see in these top tables, that kind of thing. I think someone ran the stats, and it was roughly a one-third split on the factions in the top tier. Scum having a good bit of variation. All but one top 16 Rebelist having a K-Wing. Ashley Gale of Bristol Renown rocking his... What was it? It was Miranda Ghost?
So he had a very interesting... He had Kanan, Ezra and Biggs list. So rocking those auto blasters.
Yep, and of course Kanan behind the... Kanan keeping the damage off Biggs, keeping Biggs alive longer, frustrating your opponents. But interesting to note, yeah, Rebels, every list bar one had a K-Wing. Imperials, every list had a Defender. Scum, it's a good little bit of variation, though we are seeing the preponderance of Mind Link.
Yeah, it's incredibly strong. And Andy Cameron there with a bit of a cheeky dropping the old range 3 ruler down. Might have a word with him about that. So we'll keep an eye on that cheeky little side, that's a bit of a no-no. But I've been terrible. I came down here to record some games and play. Managed to miss most of the Swiss because I was too focused on playing. But we are streaming the top table.
You can always tell when you're playing games, Liam, because there's a corner seething and agony.
I was fine in the first four games. And went a bit downhill from there. So Curtain Games are streaming these. They're going to put these on their YouTube channel after doing a bit of editing. I've also been recording the second table from the cuts. And they're going to be going on my own YouTube channel. It's I now have a brand account, apparently. I'm eligible for one because I've got enough videos, enough views, enough subscribers. So it's youtube.com/C/thegaminghall.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, it's gaming. My surname's Hall, you know.
Beautiful.
I can't take the credit. Richard Greenway.
Yeah.
It was his idea.
And that's why the BBC pays him all that sweet, sweet salary.
That's why he gets the sweet, sweet money, you know. The world-renowned, famous Greenway clan.
Yep, getting that name drop as well. Others who enjoy their name drops, we will.
I've been told I should be contractually obliged that once I mention the Greenways, I should also mention the Boltons as well.
Yes, Steve Bolton, Alex Bolton, both rather good players. Alex with that savage whisper play. Lots and lots and lots of sensor jam, a rebel captive, just something you don't want to shoot, but you have to shoot.
So you'll be pleased to know that as well, that we do actually have a dice cam for this game. So, yeah, we should actually be able to have a better view of...
not be subjected to our guesses as to the results. Well, I imagine you probably still will be, depending on how good my eyesight is.
Yeah. So we've got a bit of a... straight out the traps here from Mr. Cameron.
He's coming in strong. He's been playing more conservatively recently with his list. I think he got a couple of pastings, but it looks like he wants that K-wing gone. And after seeing what those cluster mines can do to Fenn in other games...
he's got a game plan. I think he's heard what happened to Alex's fangs, and to be honest, doesn't really want to take that risk.
No, I can't blame him at all.
Early games, he's playing quite aggressively with that fang, and lost one of his games, and just got it too close to a party bus. And he's been playing very conservatively since, and it's worked well into his favour. But yeah, knowing how much of a pain that K-wing can be if it's still around, I think game plan's definitely going to be to get that off as quickly as possible.
Just looking at Manaru here, I thought Manaru would... what did Manaru do with this one? Start the back, barrel backwards?
Yeah.
Anyway, I can see if it being there position-wise. So yeah, Andy Cameron coming in here, possibly going to put some big hits on that K-wing as he goes past with the Lancer. Assange Ventress, she goes out, starts ringing around the board again. Snap Wexley positioned to come in, or pop right, depending how Michael Bonney wants it. Is it Bonney or is it Bonner?
Bonney.
Mike, there we go.
Mike. Player one. So Assange been able to give out that stress.
Oh.
Give out that stress, it's really going to limit where that K-wing can... go.
Yeah, and the bomb usage as well. Of course, the Sarge can, you know, he's carrying Lazzarazzi as well, who can spend that stress when defending against it off of the opponent to add and evade her results. Strong ability, but you've got to weigh it up against the ability to leave them stressed. I think that K-Wing doll is not bad for the Greens.
No, it's not too shabby, actually. K-Wing doll is very nice.
Yeah. No, we need some Y-Wing love. That's what we need.
So, Manaru's palming off. And that old, give away a focus, get a focus back.
He's out of range, but he's demonstrating excellent gamesmanship there. Not skipping any stages, making sure that, you know, he doesn't leave himself open, especially this time of night. What is this, game number 9 for the players?
Yes, this will be game number 9.
Game number 9. A lot of people haven't travelled down at least an hour or two.
This is the one downside with one-day events. They're starting to see it now. We've seen some more two-game events with regionals. And it becomes a fatigue thing. So we've got 3 hits there. 2 of 8. And a focus. So Andy managing to stave off the first salvo from Nora.
Those green dice, they can be your best friend, but often they won't.
Interesting, it looks like Assange hasn't given out any stress.
And I think there's range 3 engages all round here. But gets an extra green die. Green die against 3 versus guaranteed evade against 1. But of course, Andy here not having the... had the move before Nora and Snap.
Just line up where he's going to
can I aim for?
Yep, K-Wing fear is real.
A very, very aggressive start from both players.
We've got Michael Bonney here looking to get a quick kill.
Can you just ask Andy to use the dice bowl, please?
Andy Cameron.
Yep.
Rolling them the way he likes, and they put them in the dice bowl for us all to see.
That's fine. As long as we can see it, that's all that matters.
The fruits of his. I'll say it's labour, it's a hobby after all.
So, Spencer Focus for 3 hits.
Oh, seeing symbols.
Yep, spend that focus, only takes one.
That's not what Andy wanted to see there.
So very conservative with Manaroo and very conservative with Fenral, which not
surprising with that K-Wing in. So
he's got to be careful because he could be in danger of leaving the Sarge.
I know, I've seen a straight way, if you can control the enemies pointing their guns well enough, circle over damage on a Sarge, get your Nagatur, get her out, cycle in Manaroo.
So it's interesting how Michael is going to approach the next couple of turns. So seeing Andy's list, he's not actually played against the Shadowcaster before.
No, he might not be expecting that big three move. They do move at pace. And that mobile,
especially that five forward as well.
Oh yeah,
it's an absolute monster.
But those rocks, you know, with the cable going first, strong blocking potential here. I don't think anybody's particularly happy with the positioning right now. But of course, Michael Bonney having the advantage, having all three ships pointing directly at one of Andy's. Yeah, it's a good opening for Michael there, losing no shields and getting two off Assange. We had a confirmation from roving reporter Anthony Yates of a top 8 fame. Anthony Yates claiming that he got good. Debatable, but I will leave that one up for the chat. Cool. Michael Bonney perhaps overcooking his move here. Looked like he wanted to slam to a turn, a right turn, and drop a line of clusters in front of Assange. Getting three clusters on hold would have been a big, big play right now, but just overcooked it slightly. It doesn't have that slam maneuver available to him.
Taking a second to think about his options. He wants a Sarge. He wants a Sarge badly.
Yeah. Well, if he can kill a Sarge right out of the gate this game. Oh, he's really going for it. Excellent.
Yeah.
Excellent thinking. Or a premature pop of the clusters there. Because if Assange goes left, they're gone. That's it. They're out of the game, those clusters.
I think he might have blown his load a bit too early on that one.
No. I'll tell you,
head to head against a K-Wing, I can't see Andy wanting to blows straight forward.
But then again, Michael Bonner, top four currently. So, you know, we'll see what happens when Andy puts his shots down. Manu coming in here, three back left.
So, where's he going?
Taking that target lock. And here's the... who's got on?
Yeah, turning away.
Yeah. Yeah, one bank, giving him a nice, good shot out next turn. So that K-wing, not in arc, unless he moves that arc round. And we've seen how much Andy hates those K-wings. Maybe less now, there's only one bomb left.
Again, what are you more fearful of though? Potential two dice, naked two dice from the K-wing?
Yeah.
You know? He's dodged one set of bombs. And the position is at the moment, the way he's turning round, they're not going to cause any issues for the rest of the game?
No. But, as we've seen before, many games and on stream today, that just one class of one left, that could be Fenn.
Yeah.
Fenn at the moment, completely irrelevant to the game state. Unless he can pop round, get some shots on the end.
Andy wants to keep Fenn as far away from the action for as long as possible.
Yeah.
Come in when he needs it. I mean, seeing in the last couple of games, played fairly cautiously. Some hits and runs, only brings Fenn in when he really needs to finish something off.
Especially with that PS9, getting to kill them before they go. And that's what I really like about the last couple of waves. You've seen a lot of mid-PS ships coming again.
Yeah.
PS becoming much more interesting again.
You used to pretty much see 9s, 10s
yeah.
to get it. Majority you're seeing now, 6, 7, 8s.
Yeah, so defenders, whoever designed the defenders did a good job on that one. Especially Riad, excellent, brilliant, very efficient for their points. But only PS5. Oh. So Anthony H there, who didn't win today using defenders.
So Paul was running his defenders. So he's running Riad with VI.
Oh, nice.
And he was running Vessery and Glaive with adaptability.
Okay.
So gets the option of having everything to pilot skill 7. So half decent shot over most things.
Yeah.
And can move them whenever he wants.
Not bad.
Whichever order he wants.
Very, very handy stick on flicks.
Good number on me. He tanked up with a size to the evade.
The snap works coming here. Will not get the outmaneuver bonus against Manaru.
So he's giving the stress to snap, moving the tokens off, and the target lock.
He wants that K-wing gone.
So, is the target lock on the K-wing? The target lock looks like it's on snap.
Snap.
Yeah.
Oh, of course, yes, out the mobile firing arc.
So no shot from Fenn. So we're moving on to Nora.
Big range one target lock focus shot into the front of Asajj. That's a strong play. And there we go. That looks like five hits to me. It's a strong five hit. That is not good news for Andy Cameron.
That's not what he wants to see.
We've been saying how Nora suffers without her regen.
Oh, and there's a blank there.
Nora does not need regen when she's putting out that much damage.
What we've got? We've got focus and evade. So blocks two, takes three.
Is that block two, block one?
So block two, so he focused and evaded.
Ah, with the evade token, yep.
So loses.
That's a crit coming through.
Oh.
Was that a minor or a major? A major explosion goes off, that's two crits. Okay, so the major explosion didn't go off. There was a second crit there that got through, which was an agility reduction by one. So that's the Lancer, Asajj Ventress, down to one agility.
So all of a sudden, that K-Wing looks a bit more scary.
Yeah, and there's only two, well, two damage at least got through there, through the shields. So you can five health, agility one. It's a Y-Wing.
Yeah.
Be interested to see how Andy plays this. Andy, veteran gamer, he's you have to get to this level. You're going to get spikes like that against you. It'll be very interesting to see how he deals with that now. I think we might see some more Fenn play here. He swaps out. Asajj brings Fenn in.
Yep. So Asajj is going back at Nora. Oh, spends that focus.
Oh.
Oh. This is a bloody game.
Well, four damage straight into her. That's going to poke straight through those shields.
So she'd already lost a shield last on the first round.
Oh, that's a crit as well.
Stunned. So stunned pilot.
Stunned pilot. Now, I correct in thinking that's if you overlap somebody or an obstacle, you take a damage.
Yep.
So Manaru is an expert at blocking that barrel roll and the tight ones.
The other match is just snap fights. One shield off one defender, two off defender.
So two hits. So two hits from snap on Manaru and only managing to evade one. So as it stands, these trade-offs are going just going into Michael's favour at the moment.
Yeah, Michael must be happy with these trades. Manaru looking to get that kill. Yeah, Andy, you know, surely his ships can't withstand firepower of this magnitude.
So focuses into two hits.
Nora's picking up another damage card there.
Well, I think he was doing a range one on snap there, actually.
Oh, nice.
So shields come off snap.
Okay.
Here's that plucky K-Wing. Oh, we hear the yes as Andy manages to avoid the damage.
Mm.
So interesting opening salvo. I think Andy really pressure's a bit on now. Andy needs to get Fenn in and start getting those trades back in his favour.
We are seeing Michael's guys coming down to the point where Fenn can just come in and kill them before they shoot.
Yeah, Nora's now. I mean, we've seen it. Once he gets that Atani stack,
yeah,
he's regularly smashed in those. Five dice range one.
Yeah.
That's enough to take Nora off the board.
And, you know, let's be honest, in this list, Lats, she's the most expensive, but the other two just by themselves working together in the late game is incredible.
Yeah. And Andy's shown, survive the opening salvo, go off, lick your wounds, and then work out what needs to do. And we've seen it, we've seen in the top 16, we've seen in the top 8, and Andy's not afraid to fly around, keep it at range when need be. Yeah.
And he's got
take it into that final,
yeah,
that final joust.
And he's got that he's got that confidence to know that 10 hit points,
yeah,
behind two agility, there's very few lists that can take that down.
And he's got the agility, he's got the maneuverability.
Yeah.
And
that sweet, and he's got the evade as well. So you don't trust your dice.
And when you're at this range, he's also got the patience as well.
So
and that's a big thing. It's very easy to fly around, get frustrated, get bored, wanna fly in and finish it off. And it's just having that patience to just sit back for as long as you need and take it in when it counts.
I mean, that's the one thing between a good player and a great player, is that patience to know where to make your shots, where to make your plays. Don't not going for that. You know, get damage this turn, going for that, get the kill.
And that's why I'll never be a great player. I am not patient enough.
I just want to get it. I just want to get it.
I just get bored. Yeah. So it's going to be an interesting turn here because it's going to be back and forth. So there's a lot of.
Snap works there.
So it's gonna be K-Wing, Manaru, Snap, Asajj, then Nora, then Fenn.
That's about right. I think Snap's yep. Pissick, isn't he? Yeah. So Snap here, got the R2 Astromech, so he can do a two turn, clear that stress. But of course what's crippling at the moment is he can't T roll and he can't K turn. Which is what, you know, Manaru's gonna be able to use that.
So we've got a three bank there for that K-Wing.
Is he gonna come and drop those bombs, get a gun before she shoots?
I think it might be a bit too far away.
Yeah.
Problem is, do you hold off and wait for Fenn to come in?
It's tricky. I mean, you've got to see, he's setting up here for a bomb shot, but I don't think he's going to have the shot. I mean, Manaru, she's not going to hurt from two clusters. I mean, Andy Cameron probably quite likes to take the clusters right now on Manaru. Yeah,
so
and there
like
we go.
He's holding off. He's waiting. He's buying his time. Goes for the focus. We've only one set. He's got to buy his time.
Yeah.
He's got to wait and make sure that when he drops them, that at least two of them hit a ship.
Yeah.
Because if he drops them there, I mean, there's a lot of those other cluster mines. They're going to sit there. And they block a lane, but.
It's a fairly bare bones game.
And he doesn't need to go over there.
You know, I was seeing some of this today. Two K wings, 10 bombs in the list. This K wing, 2 bombs. You've got to make them count.
Yeah. You can probably afford to waste one set, but bear in mind he's not got much. Well, he's not really got anything once those bombs are gone. So he's got to make that second set really count.
Yeah. And Andy Cameron pulling Superman poses over the top of the board just off camera. Nicely, good-natured game, but very, very technical and obviously highly competitive at this point. Each looking to play that 10th game in one day.
And just going back, I mean, that's probably the unfortunate bit about what has been the current norm for FFG X-Wing schedules. Mm. Just the immense amounts of games. You get to top four, final. At this point, they've been playing 16, 17 hours of X-Wing. And it just gets to that point where it's fatigue. And who's got the endurance? Who can stay awake? And ultimately, who can make the fewest mistakes?
I think a lot of that goes into some of the good lists at the moment as well. I mean, you look in the past, you look at Triple Intercept. Triple Intercept used to be, you played it correctly, no one could touch you. But it was on you. You made one mistake, you went. You look at similar lists now, you look at Defenders. There's something Chris Thurston, who if you ever get a chance to read or talk to him about X-Wing, he makes a lot of very good points. But there's a lot of the best lists have a strong buffer zone. A space in which you can be, one, not a great player.
Yep.
Also, two, have the dice, have the random number generator just take disliking to you. When you look at Defenders, you know, they've got the token stacked for the first shot, maybe get some hot dice on the second, might take some damage on the third shot.
Yeah.
Okay. You look at this list here with the apparent time, you get blocked twice, you still get focus across your list, and somebody gets double focus.
Yep. It's one of those, at the end of the day, this is a game of dice. You make a lot of your own luck.
Completely.
Through.
I mean, you do see the same players time and time again
top
table.
Dice, with target locks, rerolls, focus. Ultimately, the range of dice statistics, probabilities come into play. And some of these lists that get to the finals, they're more forgiving, particularly when you're getting to that point where the mental fatigue starting to kick in a little bit.
Oh yeah, completely.
Be interesting to see what some of the people on who are watching think. Probably got half a dozen people probably listening to us going, what the hell are you talking about?
Could you chaps just stop talking now? Let's watch our X-Wing in peace, please. Well, then that's what the volume dials for.
Just
that, isn't
shut
it?
Up and give us the facts.
So, quick stats corner for those of you who are interested. Evade versus focus. If you have three defense dice, they're statistically even. You know, focus statistically worth one evade of one three. Green dice. Above that, focus is better. Below that, the evade is better. So Asajj here with her two greens, that evade, very strong play. And you see Andy use that a lot. Obviously limits his offensive output, but defensively, excellent play. And with that kind of hole, you just went down over time.
Yeah. Apologies for any background noise, but some of the games of side event games are finished. They're just moving some of the tables out of the way. So if you hear any background noise, apologies. It hopefully won't last very long.
I've got to say, I've been very impressed with Curtain Games side events. And we're saying side events. They're running an Imperial Insult side event. And they're running an X-Men side event.
Imperial Insult?
Imperial Insult.
What's an Imperial Insult?
Imperial Insult. It's getting very
political. Maybe you're not allowed to swear.
Well, no. No, ever since. No. but when we say side events, they're doing their 3-round quarter one kit tournaments.
Oh yeah. They are not messing about.
No. So yeah, you got 5 Imperial Assault players. Well, 4 R5 drops, playing for a full quarter one prize kit. You've got 16, or was it?
Ten players for X-Wing.
Yeah. A bit of list swapping I've been seeing as well. People going, oh, I've been playing this list all day. I'll swap this hot list with this guy. So lots of people playing lists. They haven't been playing all day. Asking lots of questions as to why others chose those lists.
The Q1 kits are interesting. So from seeing them from when we used to have the big boxes, then the small packets, now they're in small little boosters. They're refining them more, but ultimately there's actually less in each kit. Because you used to be able to get, I think the last one, you get 6 or 7 sets of tokens. In this one, there's only 2 sets of Tractorbeam tokens, but there's 2 sets of 5.
Yeah, it does seem like, which is weird, because Tractorbeam tokens, if you ever need 5, and one, I don't know what your list is, but...
I can get 5.
Is there a title for Shadowcaster that lets you keep?
Yep, so there is an upgrade we'll actually keep, but Shadowcaster allow, if you're throwing lots of tractor beams out.
Yeah.
But Ketsu can drop 2 by herself.
I feel ashamed, I forgot the name of the chap who ran it, but one of the guys from Where's Gaming down Bournemouth. Excellent shop down there, by the way, in Bournemouth. They've got 3 gaming shops in a 1 mile radius. So if you ever look at leading a game on the South Coast, there's quite a few there. Strong community links. But he was running 4 Bs with tractors and FCS.
Yeah. He was on the first game. I started recording in the game. I managed to miss the first 5 minutes. And I think I lost the first 5 minutes because I forgot to delete the memory cards.
He's got that because of Banzai painted B-Wing.
Yes, it looks really good. So, back to the action. So it looks like Michael's coming round for another pass, but still going to have... So
Mannery putting in that 2S loop, getting her front arc on, giving her some manoeuvre, get back in the game. We've got a snap here, just clearing his stress out, getting that target lock. And yeah, there's a lot of rejigging this turn. There'll be some shots. I wouldn't expect to see any major damage popping out this turn.
Ooh, so we've got a bit of an update on the Luke and Simon. So Vessery has the crit of all turns, all hard turns are red, and Dengar's taking a bit of damage himself.
Hitting a crit. Ooh. So that's 3 health left on Dengar.
So that's going to be a very, very cagey final. So they've been practice. They practice a lot. They're local players. They play
Yeovil boys.
Yeovil.
7 fingers and 12 toes.
regional stereotyping. It's nice to see such a strong representation from across the southwest, and others even further abroad. Some people travelling down from quite a way today to play. But I do believe the top 4 here are relatively local.
Yep. So Michael is from Bridgewater, so not too far. Just a little bit up the M5. Andy is from a bit further up. He's up near Worcester.
That part of the country, yeah. no one knows about. It's
up north somewhere.
Yeah.
It's either the M4 or it's up north.
Yeah, that's the one.
It's not too far. I think it's about an hour away from us when he comes.
I did see a good definition the other day. It was from the north is anything above the line that goes from the bottom of the armpit of Wales, as I call it, where we're at the bottom, up to the top of the hump of East Anglia.
M4 corridor. Yeah. M4, M25.
Right, I'm from Winchester, so Bristol's north to me.
So, dials are coming up.
It's going to be a very interesting turn here to see how the players get back and play. We've got quite a dispersed area at the moment. Neither player able to really come in a decisive way this round. Manor will be the interesting one.
So Michael just needs to be a bit careful here. So Andy's going to start bunching himself up, give Assange a bit of breathing space. But with a turret and with Assange's mobile firing arc, Michael's just got to be a little careful, because if he brings them up piecemeal and almost starts feeding them to Andy, he could be in a bit of trouble. So he's just got to...
Michael just taking a step around the table, assessing the angles he's got to play with there. Michael also able to hear us, which is a bit awkward. But a big grin on his face. Yeah, he's clean out on a good day. It's nice to see a good natured top four game. All four players smiling. And here we go, big swing in from Assange. Bringing that powerful ability, that strong three attack, back into the game. I'll be looking to capitalise on a potentially slightly out of place Michael here. We see Nora's really going to struggle to get herself relevant this turn. Andy potentially looking to prey upon the other two while they're exposed.
It's the thing, if Knapp's making a turn in, could...
Now, is this a turn or a T-roll? T-roll.
It's a T-roll.
So Mike had to be careful here not to pick up range 2 of Assange and get double stress.
It's range 1 to 2. Spending is only on the attacker, isn't it? Because he's got Lat's crew. So there's no range restriction on Lat's crew, is there?
I don't believe so, no. Michael coming in here to range 2. Now, is he assuming that there will be a stress spent in defence and using that to his advantage here? Yeah, diving for that kill.
So, Andres, we're talking about that range 2 bulb, and he stuck himself straight in the middle of it.
And it gives Andy Cameron an interesting choice. If he gets that double stress, do you use it defensively? You know, if it's a difference between you dying and living, potentially yes, but if it isn't, do you take a damage or leave him double stressed?
Because he's still one damage on side, so he probably afford to take music control.
So, because if two voices weren't enough, our roving reporter, whilst he's waiting to be sent out on a fetching mission for information, is coming to join us. He's chucked a pair of headphones on, so say hello, Anthony.
Hello, everyone.
So we're now peaking at 72 viewers. Hello, viewers.
So Anthony, now instead of making the side comments, going to inform you all with his wisdom as the highest ranked player out of three of us today.
I'm not sure wisdom is quite what I'd call it, but you know.
Okay, hot green dice.
Hello, I've definitely not had that today.
So to show
there's a reason I brought the Decimo, it doesn't need to roll any.
So the question here for Michael is, do you try and finish off Lats? Assange? Or does he make use of that outmaneuver on Manaru?
I think if you can kill Assange, that's the stronger. You can't afford to leave Assange in the opening game, which is so hard to bring down. She can guarantee two damage not going through every time. Yeah, stress and the evade token.
That's a huge damage mitigation against one target.
If you can bring to the end game with just Assange and two of your ships, you've got a good odds there.
Ooh. Andy with an aggressive roll there, matched by a similarly aggressive roll from Michael. As we all know, the harder you throw a die, the more likely it is to obey you.
So that's another damage. So there's 3 hole left on Nora.
Nora's feeling the pain. We've seen Michael use that BB-8 to such good effect last game. But two more points and you get the regen of R2. I think he's got a point bid as well.
Nope, he's bang on 100.
Bang on 100? Oh, that does make it tricky to find 2 points. And like Cawin, we were saying, such a bare bones Cawin.
It's bare bones Cawin, but it's doing the job.
Getting it done. Well, K-Wing is still alive. It's currently obscured by the dice tray, but you can just see a tip of its wing sticking out. And Fenn just hanging around, and this is what we're saying about the confidence of Andy Cameron. He's playing the game with two ships currently, leaving Fenn entirely for the end game. Very strong play.
We're just sending our roving reporter out to find out what that crit was.
There's a lot of cards being drawn there. It looks like it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, he dumped the droid before he...
Was that two damage on Snap then?
I didn't see it.
Snap Wexley burning his astromech. Which of course is an R2 unit, 1 point. Excellent little astromech, gets you that extra whole point. But yeah, not worth
it's
a huge amount.
You can get that nasty crit coming through and... The loss of the extra green manoeuvres is an easy choice to make the crit go away.
Very close game so far.
So it's just the old one damage. With Michael burning the astromech. However, big swing in the other game. It was a trade-off of Dengar and Vessery.
Yeah.
So Dengar is off the board, and it's just full health Manaru.
Full health Manaru,
against Palp and Ryad.
That's a trade I'd take quite happily.
Yeah, I think Ryad's going to be happy with that. Especially the PS5, talking about earlier, beating Manaru's PS4.
Yep. So,
he is running Painbot on Manaru, so... Still not a guaranteed easy take, but
it
depends how the dice come back on it.
Has he got Gonk on
the
Manaru?
Yeah.
So he's got Gonk, and he's also got the...
Revenge Bot. R5P8, R5P9.
Plasmas are on... They were on Dengar, weren't they?
So that should be a dud for him.
That should be interesting. So it's going to come down to how quickly can he get Palp off the board.
Yeah.
To get back into that, but at the moment that's very much looking like it's swinging in Luke's favour at the moment. But you know they're still just over half an hour to go.
Simon Richardson, not yet out of it. Decent player, good list.
Yeah.
Jump Master's very manoeuvrable. Still got a strong chance.
Especially you can get in close and just start blocking Riyard.
Yeah, and Palpatine.
Yes, just start taking shots. Palpatine on.
No more shots
for. Unassailed by the defender.
No more shots for OGP. Just over half an hour left here, and no deaths yet. But I believe we have seen a half hulling of Sarge. Of course, Sarge. Taking the brunt of the attacks, but she's just got so much soak. Andy here, confident in the fact that X-Wing can't cater and can't T-roll, able to go in close. And we know how much Andy hates that K-wing. Looking to get it gone while a second cluster can go off.
That's a fairly reasonable position to have. They are frustrating.
I say we're looking at Commonwealth Defenders, potentially Commonwealth Defenders, Paratini final here. It's been interesting, the old filth and the new filth.
I don't quite know. Whoever wins, we all lose.
I will say this though, there was a lot of hate for Dengaru. And you watch the World Finals, and yeah, you see the way that man threw that list. You know, the barrel roll set up for the shot. The fact that he was using the fact that he knew he'd only have to clear the width of the range ruler. Force the early engage. If anybody wants to see it, you don't have to watch the whole thing. Just the World Final from last year. The opening moves, almost won entirely on the opening few moves.
So, speaking of Worlds, for those who haven't seen, lovely bit from FFG where they announced that from next year, the winner of Worlds will be a... paid to go back, so they'll get their travel and accommodation paid for. Not this year because it wasn't won by a Yank.
Yep.
The wonderful Jess must set up the old GoFundMe. I chucked a little bit into it.
Jesper Hills of the 186 Squadron. I'd say you listen to the podcast, he has some of the best chat you come across.
Oh yeah, well, we're on it. 186 podcast, lovely listen. If you ever have to listen to one podcast, go give those guys a listen. They're great bunch of chaps. Always good to have a catch up and a socialise. Got to go over to Nordic Nationals last year and spend a bit of time with them. But yeah, so Jesper set up the old GoFundMe, and yep. Less than 24 hours, and we're sending the current world champion,
Nand Torfs.
So won by Belgium. Yeah. So we're sending him back to Wales next year to go and. Show you those filthy colonials what's what.
Indeed. I was going to say bring the pain, but that would be outrageously American of me to say.
Well, nothing really unusual for you, but...
Okay, so... Again, almost as bad as saying lock and load before you start your game.
So stress is snap.
Fenn roaring back into the action now.
Is he going to be an Arcanor, are they?
I don't think he's got a shot there.
From this angle, doesn't look like he's going to have a shot.
Roving reporter Anthony Yates is just going to go check it out.
Go forth, minion. Mush, mush.
Yes, master.
Yeah. Know your place.
Anthony hobbles away. He has got an Arcanor. Yeah, okay, yeah. So Fenn has got a shot on the back of Nora there. So we could potentially see a Nora kill here. It's a shame, she's just made herself relevant again. Andy Cameron playing excellently, getting the tempo just right. And tempo is not a word you often hear used in a reference to X-Wing.
Ooh.
Oh, so sorry.
So Nora's gone for a...
Slight correction there. Nora can shoot Fenn. Fenn cannot shoot Nora. Do we know what the range was? Range 1, I believe?
It was pretty close. Range 1 or 2.
So, of course, big issue for Fenn here is that without having arc, he doesn't get his free extra evade. And without that, you can just get diced off the table.
No, if he's caught a range 2 of Nora's back up.
So, who is shooting?
Usually a question that if you have to ask, it's going to go very badly for you. But, of course, in the hobby world...
So, 2 hits on Nora. So one goes through, so 2 hole left for Nora.
And as Andy Cameron says, it all adds up. Snap goes to shoot. Snap taking that range 3 shot of Manaru. And I have to say, Andy has done an excellent game of chopping and changing who's taking the hits here. Snap rolling 2 hits.
So 2.
Yeah, Andy
2
coming in strong, yeah.
Yeah, he really is a master of dividing the shots up between his ships.
He's got to be done.
Yeah.
I mean, you can bring as much hull as you like, but you've got to make sure it's used.
Yeah. I've got to admit, I didn't quite appreciate that until I started flying 4 U-wings. Yeah. And when you're flying those, you have to be able to jink in and out, feed them piecemeal, because if you can spread the damage and keep 4 on as long as possible, it's a completely different game.
It's my favourite thing is when an opponent asks, so which one of all these X-Wings has got one hull point left? Oh, that's the one that's behind you. Take that, defenders.
Do you remember focus firing your X-Wings down quite successfully the last time we played?
So you've seen snap quickly there getting taken out.
So a big shout out to Richard Greenway, who's just managed to get home.
Congratulations on getting home, Richard.
With the boys, and they've jumped straight onto Twitch to watch some games before going to bed.
Boys, let me say, well done today. It's some excellent play and some strong sportsmanship.
Yeah. You know, speaking of sportsmanship, it's got to be said that the X-Wing crowd are fantastic. So little Simon Greenway.
Oh, that's so great.
Fantastic guy, yeah. Only 10 years old, but very good player. He's still learning the game. Comes up, lost his fourth round game, I believe, and came over to us for rules question because he wasn't quite sure for next time. So he was running Dengar and I believe a Bosk party bus.
It's been really nice seeing the evolution of Simon as a player. Remember the first time I played him, he was running Chewbacca. Double TRT Y-Wing,
yep.
Which you may think of as, you know, a fairly easy to run list, but I'll tell you, the second I tried to play him against it, got in deep in range one, both Y-Wings went each way, couldn't get away from them both, but and he beat me, straight out.
Great way of starting, but Dengar went off the board, asked us a question, wasn't quite sure, turns out that Dengar should have actually had his shot back before he died, as in the FAQ, so he told his opponent for next game, and the guy went, okay, cool, let's roll off then, see if he would have killed me, and... He killed the guy.
Oh, wow.
And they went into final salvo. So narrowly lost, but some fantastic sportsmanship.
You don't
normally see in some other things. So.
No, the X-Wing community is really quite amazing.
So Andy's now turning away with Manaroo. And what is going on with that K-Wing? Ah, so K-Wing's bumped into...
I think that's exactly how Andy wants it. He's going to be able to just soak Nora here.
And I'm not quite sure how we managed to miss this, but Snap Wexley's now off the board.
Oh, yeah. So I think Snap was killed by...
I think it was Manaroo's turn.
I think Manaroo popping the last few damage through there.
Yep.
And yeah, he's switching fire to Nora now. This game moving swiftly away from Michael's control.
Yeah, with Nora that low, it's a relatively simple matter to bring her down. Without regen, she's focus the fire down, she disappears pretty quickly.
Another basic X-Wings for those of you who are familiar, though I suspect at this time of night on this channel you're all experts. But unless the ship has boost and barrel, can use both at the same time, or they can slam, if you can occupy the space they left, they cannot escape your firing arc with any normal manoeuvre by itself.
You're full of fun facts, you?
Yeah, it's almost like I can't play without analysing the game.
I know.
I'll try and hide that.
Oh, you've managed it so far today.
So, again, managing to...
So this is going to stop that target lock
focus. Get a Sarge in the action, get those bumps where it counts, and we could very well see Fen Rao finishing the job. So Nora only got two hit points left.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got that stack of tokens.
We'll see him here. Here comes
the big one.
We'll see him here, close to the range one. If he doesn't get it ready, get a target lock, range one. As we said earlier, statistically, that's a kill.
Oh, especially with an 8-2.
Well, he is very consistent, getting that range one and getting those five dice and making full use of it.
Yeah.
It's nice to see the Fang actually as a ship. You've got to have range three, you've got to have range one.
Yeah.
And if you get range two, you're gone.
Yeah, there's a big
So we've got the target lock coming on, so... Ah, so he's put the target lock on the K-Wing.
I wonder if he's just confident enough that he'll be able to bring it down with just the focus.
No, he's got confidence that he's going to be able to bring it down with just the Lancer, possibly. Oh, yeah. I think you're right, confident he can bring it down with just the focus. But yeah, that's a kill on Nora there. K-Wing here, yet to use its second clusters, but I...
Did we even see dice?
I saw a red die come from Michael there, but...
Was it them suddenly realising that... Was it
console fire?
Possibly, she had stunned pilot, didn't she?
Ah, yeah, you're right, she did have stunned pilot.
From hitting a Sarge. So yeah, console fire would do it. would make sense why you wouldn't set the lock on.
So we saw
Andy here slamming a big 4 damage at that side arc and black. That's 4 damage going through. This is last shield. So 3 damage going into the K-Wing. K-Wing now on 2 hull.
This is looking very good for Andy now.
Riving Porter, Anthony Yates checking out the second game.
What? Just going to send our Raven Reporter out. It didn't look. Did that look like double damage?
No, I don't think so, but they haven't shaken hands yet.
Oh, all turns are red now for that K-Wing, so that's...
That's a big deal. That's a lot of its movement.
That is going to hurt.
And it's stressed as well at the moment off of Sarge. No, if I was a betting man, I would get awful odds on Michael right now.
But let's be honest, though. In fairness to Michael, I said before, this is the first big event.
Super impressed with that.
I've been playing this game for 2 years, and I've made cut once.
Fair. He's going home with all.
And got subsequently smashed out of it by Simon.
Simon Greenaway, you know, wrecking dreams of grown men.
It was even worse. It was Simon Richardson.
Simon Richardson.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh wow. Sorry, I heard of a Simon who was good at the game and just immediately went to the ten year old.
We love you, really, Simon.
And seeing this matchup, he's never come across Paratini. He's never come across against a Shadow Caster before.
I think he had the right idea.
He had the right idea. Yeah.
He made the right play, but it's just that soak, the amount of hole you've got to get through. I think that early pop of the clusters. It'd be interesting to talk to him after the end of the game. See what his thinking was there.
We'll get him on. We'll have a chat. We'll kick out in the off quickly. And
little quick update on the other game first.
You got an update for us?
Yeah. So Riaz still has 1 shield.
Yep.
Mallory hasn't taken anything off. Seems to be at full strength still. With three on Gonk.
Is Palp still on the board?
Yep.
Ooh. Very, still, very cagey game.
Shuttle still has shields.
Simon Richardson possibly going for the points win. Pop in, kill Palp, and win on points versus
Riot.
He's going to
go for the Andy Cameron approach.
Hey, when MME doesn't count, that's how you get the wins. Yeah. And top 4 of a 100-plus regional. I'm impressed. You know, you say what you like about ways of winning the game. The game is what it is. It's the game we love to play.
Yep. Yeah.
It is a bit tricky to get that last turn pop with Manaru then compared to Fenn.
Yeah, I've been loving feedback array today.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's been a real game.
I use these all the time.
Oh, this is a fab, mate. What are you talking about? Current games regional 2 weeks pocket.
So we've just been reminded even though this is an X-Wing regional, that Curtin Games are also running the Imperial Assault regional in 2 weeks' time, somewhere. Didn't give us that information, so he hasn't given us all of it. But if you can go to curtaingames.com, they're international now.
Yeah.
You'll be able to get more information on their website.
Well, so very very impressed with Curtin Games. They ran. I was at an Armada region they ran last year. 21 player, which at the time wasn't good for Armada. But TO was spending most of the time walking around making everybody teas and coffees constantly.
Nice.
So there's an impressive level of service there.
I thought even deep into the cut, there was still free tea and coffee. It's the only thing keeping me awake.
Keeping that boiler going.
I must admit, I'm not looking forward to the caffeine crash that inevitably awaits us.
I'm looking forward to the caffeine crash because I'm hopefully going to be home by then. I have a can of Monster Punch.
Wow.
In the car to get me through those dodgy country lanes in the dark.
It's alright.
It's a cracking set of roads to drive in the dry and the light. Less so in the middle of winter in the dark.
So we did have the fun game on the way here of, do you listen to the Navigator or do you go for the interesting road? Sam chose the interesting roads and it was interesting. So back to the game here, we've got the K-Wing here, popping those bombs, bit of Hail Mary play there. I think really hoping to get something, hoping Andy was going to put something. Andy here closing in with a boost for the kill. I don't see a way out of this for the K-Wing.
No, I think that is
going to stop. I mean, even if K-Wing gets lucky and Andy blanks out twice, he's still got auto thrust, he's still got his focus. So looking here at 5, there's no way of soaking that.
No.
We'll see Andy resolve his dice. A big manly handshake across the table there.
We got half damage. I dropped all my bombs. That's still what counts. We have Michael
here saying he dropped all his bombs. That's what counts. Of course, he did only have two bombs, so that was significantly easier. but we'll get Michael on mic in a sec when he's ready to chat through how his game went against the mighty Andy Cameron, who is now through to the final.
Yeah. Not too bad. So.
Congratulations
to Michael. Congrats to Andy.
Still super impressed with that for his first proper tournament.
Oh, it's fantastic. I'm looking forward to having a chat. So I know Michael from Guild Ball events. So he's been up to Bristol for a few of my ones.
I hope you've all got your Andy Cameron scratch cards ready for the point where he says, "Well, I usually get this far in a tournament." that of course being the centre square. For those of you who understand bingo intrinsically.
Okay, so we've got a quick update from the Luke and Simon game. So Manaru has now got a damage card on and all shields are gone. So it's a bit of a back and forth game.
Simon Richardson chewing his fingers. He's really, really thinking hard. It's good to see that kind of deep thought going in. But right now we have you made the top two, Andy Cameron.
The very first finalist for the Curtin Games Regional. Congratulations, mate. Well done.
Thank you very much. It has not been easy. Has not been easy at all. I think the chap I've just played has played his heart out. He was exhausted. It was probably one of my easier wins, but the other two, the last two games I've just played and wasn't even able to speak about because it was like straight on to the next one.
Yeah.
Oh my God, really, so really tough.
We saw a very interesting play there. He took Fenn around the outside. You didn't really get Fenn engaged for quite a lot of the game. You're just going to run people through your thinking there.
I didn't know what the arc was going to do, and I just didn't want to get too close and get five dice in the face.
Yeah, that's not unreasonable. So I mean, this is this Paratini list. I know I have to answer myself, but how long have you been running this for?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. That's fair enough. So what are your thoughts on it as a list? Are you going to think you'd be running it going forward?
I will be running it going forwards if I lose the final. But I think if it comes to Yavin and I've already got a regional, then I will.
Four Ewings.
No.
Come on.
I will probably go for the Let's Make Vader Great Again.
We were saying earlier, there's a lot of very interesting PS6, PS9 ships out there now. PS6, PS7. Do you think Vader's got a place now with the PS9 being, not really needing as big as much as it used to?
The idea I've got with Vader is to use Swarm Leader to up his. I shouldn't be telling people this, but to.
I think we can establish that you're a good enough player. People would know what you got, Andy, and still get away with it.
Vader's biggest problem is that he does not roll enough red dice. His other biggest problem is that his green on his dial is awful.
Yep.
But other than that, he still does two actions without taking any kind of stress. Which gives you a lot of adaptability. So the plan at the moment is to use Howlrunner and four Academy ties and Vader at 34 points. Vader is 34 points with the advanced targeting computers, his title upgrade to allow him to take that for 1 point, the Mark II tie engines just to give him some more green. And then, like I say, swarm leader on there so that he can pinch evades off his Academy tie brothers and roll, what would it be, at normal range, if you can pinch two evade, it's four dice plus the extra crit if you've got something target locked, and then you just up that to five dice plus the extra crit at range one.
Nice.
Sounds pretty nice. But, you know, I can see a few weaknesses there possibly, but I'll let your opponents try and find that for you.
So, it's pretty neck and neck at the moment between Simon and Luke. Luke seems to be edging it slightly. Of the two, which would you prefer? You've got Dongaree or you've got Commonwealth Defenders. Which one are you you feeling a bit more confident about?
I have never played Commonwealth Defenders. I have played Dongaree. Dongaree's really boring. I've had a really good day. I'd rather not face in my last match something as dull as that, to be honest. It would just be, I mean, I think I'd be able to cope with it with Asajj and the stress and whatever else. I'd rather not. I'd rather go up against ships that are nipping around the board and not just sitting in the centre re-rolling dice.
Cool. Well, you've got about 10 minutes to go before this game finishes. Your last two have pretty much gone to time, so go and take a quick break and get yourself ready for the final. Get yourself a drink and, have a quick chill.
Cheers, thank you guys, and enjoy the final.
Cool, congratulations again, mate.
So we're just getting Michael up here. We can finally work out how his surname is spelt, and we can talk to him about the last game.
Yeah, it's Bonnie, like Bonnie and Clyde.
Never done this before.
So, congratulations on getting this far. Commiserations for coming so close.
Thank you.
So we've been led to understand this is your first major tournament.
Yeah, I've been to one before our club ran, but first regionals.
And you've managed to get into the old top four?
I'm as shocked as anyone.
Congratulations. We saw your game against Alex. Alex is a very, very good player.
Yeah.
One of the 186 guys, and it's worked really well. Finally came undone against the what's referred to as the Paratini.
Yeah, I couldn't break for it. I couldn't get my bomb to stick and just misjudged a few moves.
So on the bombs themselves, so we had a look around on that first run. What were your thoughts on trying to get that first bombing run set up? Because it looked like you might have been trying to get the turn to try and drop them on.
Yeah, I think I'd done a free bank the first bomb run.
Yeah.
And I just misjudged how far it's going to put me. I thought I could free bank and then free over the top of him and chuck him behind.
Yeah.
So they all land on him. Yeah. But yeah, I misjudged it. As soon as I landed, a free forward wouldn't have done it. So
I was very impressed with your bomb play in the previous run against Alex. But I'm an excellent player, and you're getting some strong kills. I mean, I've really defined the game. Do you think it made the difference in this game? Kind of missing with those bombs there.
Yeah, quite a bit. It was just misjudging the free bank, and once I was out of position, I just found it really hard to get back in.
So I've got a question about it. I don't want to take away from your list talk, because I thought you obviously played it incredibly well.
Okay.
It's worth thought out. I really like seeing outmaneuver on snap. I thought that was excellent. I'm going to get some strong kicks off that. But I've never seen Nora without R2-D2 before for the regen. Well, what are your thoughts behind the BB-8 there?
Yeah, my friend plays it with R2-D2, but I really like BB-8 because I the tournament I played before, I always ended the turn stressed because I pushed the limit. And it made me really predictable on my next move. So I used to run BB-8 on Poe, thought I'd swap it over.
Although I saw you again against Alex Burt, you did very well to kind of maintain it. He was trying to block you every turn. You kept, nope, barrel roll back, turn in. Get some really strong hits in there. They're very nice, very nice to play with it. Also, the other one, we've got Speed Ren on Nora. And then Chopper on the K-Wing.
Oh. Chopper on the K-Wing was, every time I used to get a crit on the K-Wing, it was the one where if you perform a white maneuver, you get stressed, and then I couldn't drop a bomb. So
I got... I feel like it's free.
Yeah, I got Chopper, it was free.
Yeah, free. Well,
free. I'll take the damage to drop a bomb.
So just take a quick break so people will start seeing on the stream as we're setting up for the final. Luke managed to win against Simon, so Andy gets his wish, and we have Paratini versus Commonwealth Defenders in the final.
I think that's an easier matchup for Andy, but Luke obviously a very strong player. What are your thoughts there, Mike?
I'm tired, mate. It's been a very long day.
Are you going to hang around for the final?
I might hang around and give it a watch.
Fair. But see if you're beaten by the guy that won it or by the second place.
Yeah, I'm happy to come second. Third, sorry.
No, it's an impressive placement.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations on getting so far. Commiserations for just missing out in the semi-final, but yeah, you've got yourself some lovely dice.
Yeah.
Some lovely templates, and they are some very swanky. Yeah.
It's been a good day.
All your friends are quaking for you now. That's,
yeah.
And hopefully we'll see you again on stream. I'm sure at other major tournaments.
Yeah, I'll definitely be making some more tournaments now.
So brilliant.
We really had a fun day today.
Playing Gavin?
No, not yet. Not yet. No.
Okay. But no, Michael Bonney is a name to watch, name to fear if you're a player.
And I might be stealing your list.
Oh, I've got to name it yet. I was going to call it the Not Miranda list.
Ah, I like it. Farewell.
Cool. Okay. Well, congratulations. And hopefully we'll see you at some events again in the future.
Okay, thank you.
Cool. Cheers, mate. Okay, so we're just going to take a quick couple minute break, go get a piss up, fill up on some coffee, and we will be back with the final very shortly.